it will be the 17th anniversary since TWA Flight 800 exploded. And a new documentary is set to be released on Wednesday to support the theory that the plane was hit by a missile. Well, in a convenient twist, previously confidential FBI documents have been unearthed and released to the media, tying Al-Qaeda to the TWA crash. The Daily Mail reports that the FBI had advance warning of an Al-Qaeda plot to bring down a commercial airliner on American soil just weeks before the 1996 TWA crash that claimed 230 civilian lives. A series of previously confidential FBI documents obtained by investigative journalist Peter Lance provide compelling evidence that the crash was an act of terror orchestrated by the man now believed by many to be the true architect of 9/11, Ramzi Youssef, who was one of the conspirators in the first World Trade Center bombing in 1993. Al-Qaeda never claimed responsibility for the aircraft crash. The official cause of the disaster remains an explosion of a fuel tank due to a short circuit aboard the plane. In a chilling twist, the source of the FBI intelligence was Gregory Scarpa Jr., the son of one of the mob's most prolific killers, who hoped that cooperating in the federal sting would lead to a lighter sentence for his own crimes. According to Lance, the FBI's initial attempts to dismiss Scarpa Jr.'s intelligence as a hoax was to cover up the unholy alliance between the FBI and the mob and protect a raft of mafia indictments that might otherwise have been thrown out of court. So it's just one conspiracy to cover up another conspiracy. The official story has always been that it was an explosion in the fuel tank, and now these new unearthed documents are saying that Al-Qaeda was involved. But either way you look at it, neither of these stories are focusing on the facts that a lot of people, witnesses, and National Guards said a missile struck the plane. Look over here, look over there. No, let's look at the facts. Victims' death certificates have not been finalized because the manner of death remains unknown. During the investigation, the FBI took over the case because a criminal act was suspected. Eyewitnesses reported seeing something go up quickly from the Earth's surface right before the explosion. Unexplained explosive residue was found throughout the wreckage. But the case is pending inactive rather than closed. And in addition to the hundreds of witnesses who reported seeing a streak of light in the air before the crash, there were two Air National Guard pilots in the air at the time who identified that streak as a missile. Now, here to talk with me about the curious release of these documents is documentary filmmaker Chris Emery. His team touched on the conspiracy surrounding TWA Flight 800 in his latest documentary, State of Mind, Psychology of Control, which is being sold exclusively in the InfoWars shop. All right, Chris, well, thank you so much for being here in the studio with us today.
Well, thank you for inviting me. I appreciate that. Well,
you have a lot of information on the TWA Flight 800 because you actually worked on this story for a couple of years.
I did. This was before I dove into the Oklahoma City bombing case, and I was asked to step aside from the TWA case by an intermediary through the Employees Union based out of Lambert Field in St. Louis. I was getting too close to the truth. A close family, a member of mine that was working for the airline at the time, had their job threatened, and I had to make a decision. Luckily, there was a third party that I was able to pass my research information on to that ended up giving it to James Sanders and his wife. They did a marvelous job putting out two DVDs on the case. Great follow-through and a lineup and just a thorough review of what actually happened that evening of July 17, 1996.
And so what do you think about these, the new documents that are being unearthed just in time for the...
Well, it's, you know, it's typical, a stunt that the FBI pulls. And to put this in context for the viewers, after studying Oklahoma City, which occurred in 1995, April 1995, TWA comes along 15 months later in July of 1996. The way that the narrative was pushed for Oklahoma City was completely false, according to what the Justice Department offered. That worked so well for them that they decided to roll out the same bag of tricks for TWA 800. So what they're just saying now is that Ramzi Youssef had something to do with it. Well, that's false, patently false, on his face. Evidence, damage, witnesses, everything. It's just complete bunk. There's another storyline going on that there was Scarpa, former member of the Mafia, limited hangout member of the Mafia, and he was incarcerated in Florence, Colorado. He brings out the story of Ramzi Youssef and then embellishes it. Well, we know that whole story's false. So what we're dealing with, and the Justice Department has actually become very good at this, not saying it's good, but they're aces at this game of doing a shell game. They'll go ahead and present different storylines, completely ignoring what actually happened. So that's what we have here this morning.
Right, and at the time when this came up, the FBI actually said that those materials were a hoax and that that there was no way Youssef was involved, but now exactly. They're kind of bringing it back around.
So it completely, torpedoes any credibility they have on their stories. Now, I do have to qualify that. In my research in the TWA 800 case, there were very good, very conscientious employees with the NTSB, with the FBI, with the U.S. Coast Guard, as well as a lot of search and rescue people, and the local and state law enforcement for both New Jersey and New York that knew what happened. They wanted the truth to come out. But, and there's a very good documentary that's coming out this Wednesday to commemorate the 17-year anniversary of the shootdown. The FBI pretty much enacted the equivalent of martial law on the dock. And all of the information and the evidence, everything was coming in from the bottom of Long Island Sound, was commandeered by the FBI. They only wanted one storyline to come through. Well, that's no way to conduct an investigation.
Exactly. And so and their official story didn't match eyewitnesses. It was too... Air National Guard pilots in the air at the time identified this streak in the sky as a missile.
Mm-hmm. That's correct. And in my research, even as a filmmaker, you have to go back to the basic, break it down into the simplest of terms. You have your physical evidence, the debris field. There were actually two parts of that plane that landed on, two sections that landed on the ocean floor, even though they were blown, some of it wasn't even recognizable. The front of the plane was actually... fell down first, and then the back of the plane followed. What the FBI did is they mapped the debris field in reverse. Well, that shows that it was actually, if we were to follow their storyline, it would have been an incoming flight coming in from Charles de Gaulle versus an outgoing flight from JFK. Ludicrous. Right there, we knew that something was horribly wrong. General Parton, retired Air Force general, and if you want me to go into, we had a discussion on this previously, I was at his home the third week of October of 2003. We were talking about the Oklahoma City case, nothing to do with TWA at all. After a lengthy discussion, it got to be about 4 a.m., I had to get up and get a flight early the next morning, or that morning, to go back to Oklahoma City. And I was at his home in Alexandria, Virginia. I got up from his dining room table. He looked at me point blank, plain as day, and said, "I designed the ordnance that took that plane down." And I said, "What are you talking about?" And he says, "TWA 800. So we sat down for another 4 hours, and he took me through all of the details, sketched out the debris field, what happened to the ordnance. And he said it was a special missile ordnance that they designed at the Pentagon Armament Lab. It was called a backstop missile system. If the first missile didn't take the target out, the second one would. And he showed me exactly what happened. He told me where the damage entered in to the fuselage, cut it in half like a meat cleaver. The entrance hole was about 4 to 5 feet in diameter. The exit hole was over 8 feet in diameter. There is no symmetry at all on that explosion. So, if you want to believe the FBI story of Ramzi Youssef having an explosive ordnance under the seat, you're going to have symmetry. If you want to believe the center fuel tank explosion reason, you're going to have symmetry. There was no symmetry at all in the damage of that. And the cruel thing is that when they reconstructed this plane at the Kelvington hangar, and it was a... it was a closed National Guard hangar. The reconstruction of the plane clearly shows there was no symmetry on the explosion. So why they're rolling this whole story out is completely beyond me, and it's simply not true.
And the chief fire and explosives investigator on the Flight 800 said he was absolutely certain that a spark from damaged wiring triggered the explosion of overheated fuel vapors. But you have...
Well, there were two things on that that I learned early on. That was an incoming flight from Athens, Greece, the night before. And the servo pump actually emptied that tank to 10% of its capacity. Load displacement and fuel allocation and so forth, the TWA, you don't have to have a full plane of fuel to fly to Paris. So anyway, that particular center fuel tank that they claimed blew up simply was only about 10% full. Second thing was that the faulty wiring that the FBI had claimed that was used to cause that explosion was not in any Boeing aircraft since November of 1969. And I got that piece of information from a retired, he was a senior mechanic with TWA, worked out of their Kansas City service hangar. And he said that because of a another airline, that foreign airline, that Boeing had used that wiring in, they had a catastrophic accident with that. In September of 1969, it was November of 69, Boeing took all that wiring out, and the 747, fleet of 747s, didn't hit the drawing boards at Boeing Field until 1972. Hmm. So we're talking about nearly 2.5 to 3 year complete, you know, time period where obviously they're not even going to bring in faulty wiring to put on a new aircraft. So why the FBI chose to pull that story is beyond me. And it's really unfortunate because there's a lot of good agents on there that wanted this truth to come out, and it was their testimony and their fact-finding efforts that were quashed on this whole thing.
Exactly, and it seems like the documentary that's coming out on Wednesday, it has those six investigators that were working that said that they were actually coerced or silenced by the FBI.
Sure.
And so now some people are using CNN, they aired a government-sponsored reenactment of the flight, and they said that maybe the witnesses saw the flash coming up because of the climb that the plane took.
No. There were, and according to General Parton, of course, there were actually two missiles that hit it. The first one came in actually on the right side of the plane. There was some speculation as far as it coming on the left side. Engine number three, if you count out 1, 2, 3, and 4 engine, it was following the heat trail on engine number three, and it cut the fuselage in half between rows 17 and 19. And that's when the front part of the plane. Now, what you're alluding to, referring to, is what the CIA came up with in their animation. Red flag. When the CIA shows up on an investigation, there's bound to be all kind of, you know, rabbit trails. They want their job is to deflect you from what actually happened. Mm-hmm. And as an investigative journalist, you know as well as I that you really got to stay focused, keep your eye on the ball. The CIA doesn't want you to do that. The second missile came up. And took down basically shoved the wheel housing from the first class cabin into the cockpit. The back of the plane climbed another 400 feet, then it hit the parabolic arch and started falling down. What the CIA claimed, it was went up another 4,200 feet. That's impossible. Mm-hmm. The thrust, the computers, everything on the engine simply, there's no way that the back of the plane would have climbed that high. But that was just their, you know, their diversion, their story. They wanted to get out there. It's not true.
Right, and then so the investigative journalist Lance, that has put these, you know, brought these documents to light, is saying that he's basically arguing that they're saying it was officially the wiring, and mm-hmm. he's saying no, it was actually this Ramzi Youssef. So they're sort of playing a shell game.
Exactly. You have just a simple, you know, math. You have three different shells. Well, they're actually diverting you to two. What's under the third shell? And that's what we're trying to focus on, and the truth. When you have a retired U.S. Air Force general that says he designed that ordnance at the Pentagon Armament Lab, the shared ordnance with the U.S. Navy and the U.S. Air Force, a retired senior mechanic, you have a retired United Airlines pilot who was actually a very good friend of mine out in L.A., sued the NTSB, the CIA, the FAA, and the FBI in federal court in Los Angeles. One of them, he compelled them to bring forth the evidence, and they refused to do so. So, you know, you look at this whole thing, and it's like, okay, well, we know it was shot down. We know the families were lied to. We know there was a cover-up. Why not just step up and tell these families what happened? That's the least that they deserve, is the truth. And, you know, respect the families.
So you were talking to me earlier about that there was a base or something. There was some sort of a training exercise going on there, and that's the real...
Yeah, it was a top-secret exercise going on off the coast of Long Island that evening. And from the best that General Parton was able to speculate, and some of his colleagues that he went to school with, and, you know, he served in the Pentagon with. He had since retired, obviously, back in 1978. But he got calls within about 24 hours after the shootdown stating, yes, they knew what happened. And it was a live exercise, real-time exercise, both monitored at the Situation Room at the White House. And there was a special top-secret drone that was floating about, they estimate between 62 and 68,000 feet above the earth, monitoring this whole exercise going on. TWA 800 breached the security perimeter, and it was unfortunate. I mean, just, it was a blip on the radar. And the ship that was in charge of shooting down the drones that were launched from the submarines, that's the story that I got from General Parton, mistook the TWA 800 for one of the drones. Now, what... Here's the thing that the FBI fails to mention is there were actually 25 vessels in that group, in that exercise. 23 surface vessels, 2 submarines. Every one of them, according to radar tracking from all the way from Maine down to Logan Field in Boston and JFK, all the way down to South Carolina, tracked these vessels leaving the scene of the accident. Well, why wouldn't they come back and help? And that's telltale right there. There's something horribly wrong. You have the U.S. Navy, some of the top, you know, experts in salvage and so forth. They had to wait 3 days to bring up a salvage trawler from South Carolina to bring that debris field, the debris up from the bottom of Long Island Sound. So that's another red flag.
So why do you think the truth hasn't come out about the training exercise?
That was a top secret exercise. I guess that's a question you're going to have to ask the Pentagon and the U.S. Navy. I don't know for sure. My speculation as a citizen, as an investigative journalist that stepped back and looked at this case, the government would have been sued for billions of dollars. I mean, it was a catastrophic accident. And, of course, the Atlanta Olympics were taking place during that time period, so it would have been a massive public relations disaster, too. So there was a lot of things running concurrently that it would have been more advantageous for the powers that be and then the top decision makers just to sweep this under the rug, and that's exactly what they did. But we tie into the state of mind psychology of control in a movie that's coming out this Wednesday. And we address the different techniques that the government and the media use to do exactly what's happening today. This is a prime example of what's going on. Luckily, you and I and the staff here at InfoWars have the wherewithal and the ability to step back and say, okay, we can sort through the facts and the fiction. And that's what we're going to try to do with the movie. And we give you the basic the building blocks and the tools to, first of all, put it all in context. Second, figure out who's doing it. And third of all, we give you the solutions to figure out what's going on.
Yeah, well, we have just started, actually. Anyone who orders State of Mind starting today, we have just started shipments on State of Mind. And then it's going to actually be premiering on the InfoWars Nightly News on Wednesday night. We'll also have the roundtable interview that you did with Alex.
There were actually myself and 3 other members of the crew. Richard Grove, James Lane, and Austin Green did a marvelous job in writing and directing the movie.
Wonderful. And that's going to be premiering on the 17th. You can go to the InfoWars store for State of Mind, the Psychology of Control. Well, thank you so much for being here in the studio. It was rather serendipitous that you were here to work on the shipments today so we could get you in to talk about this story. It all ties together.
Absolutely, and it's always a pleasure. Thank you so much, Leanne.
Thank you. All right, well, we're going to be taking a quick break, and then David Knight will be back with tonight's guest, Larry Pinkney.
Now you can watch the InfoWars Nightly News streaming live as it happens for free.
Check it out at InfoWars.com/show.
Are we choosing our own paths, our own destiny, or has it been pre-selected for us?
C.S. Lewis said, when training beats education, civilization dies.
We need to always be cognizant of, as a free society, that information can be used as a weapon.
Barrier to discovery is not ignorance, it's the illusion of knowledge.
We are seen as nothing but biological androids.
To gain control of education in America, not for a philanthropic purpose, but to change the thinking of the American people.
From the time we're very young, we're taught to, you know, worship authority, basically, because that's our key to survival as young children.
Discover the history, the present, and the future of mind control. From compulsory state education to the Hollywood media brainwashing machine, we are kept in perpetual bondage to the ideas that shape our actions.
In the CIA, scientists could actually film people who had been surreptitiously dosed with LSD.
There's a brain entrainment process that takes place.
That gives the government free rein to create whatever story or narrative it wants to create.
Whatever the public face of something is, whatever they're talking about publicly, there's something else over here they're probably not looking at.
How to engineer the opinion of the American people so that they would fully endorse, not only endorse, but demand a war.
When you watch mainline establishment television, you are putting yourself in front of the barrel of a gun.
Discover the history, the present, and the future of mind control. psychological warfare, brainwashing. Are we controlled and manipulated? You bet.
That's mind control par excellence.
Find out how deep the rabbit hole really goes with this new groundbreaking documentary film, State of Mind. Available exclusively at InfoWars.com.